just opened the box and there they were.
They're bloody Lizzie.
Well, it might be someone else.
Oh, it's Lizzie, all right. She never thinks what harm this could do the halfway house. She never thinks of anything but her bloody self.
But she wouldn't use half of this stuff. Why would she steal it?
Why would Lizzie do anything? All I know, she's a permanent headache. She'd be better off back inside.
Oh, you don't mean that.
If the police hit this place with a search warrant, how am I going to explain this stuff? They could close us down.
Well, what are you going to do?
Well, what can I do? Call the police.
Lizzie, isn't she beautiful?
Yeah, she's not bad for a first attempt, is she?
She's tiny.
Oh, I know, but you should have seen her when she was first born. She's doubled her weight. She was real scrawny then.
Oh. Does she look like her father?
She looks like all of them.
Come on, Chrissy, we better move you into your new home.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye, kids. Good luck.
Bye, Chrissy.
Bye-bye, love.
Bye.
Oh, what do you know? Looks like Latham might be human after all.
Well?
Oh, g'day, Rhonda. Well, what?
Are they yours?
As a matter of fact, they are.
And that fur coat? I suppose you pinched that, too.
As a matter of fact, I did. From right under their bloody noses. Do you like it?
I have had it, Lizzie.
And so have I. Searching through my things when I'm not here. It's not right.
You've got no bloody shame, have you? You don't give a damn about this halfway house or me or anyone else. All you're worried about is nicking things.
That's right.
Well, that's it. The cops are calling in. All I said was I wanted to discuss a problem, but as far as I'm concerned, they can have you.
Do you mean you shopped a mate to the law?
That's right.
That's the lowest thing I ever heard.
You asked for it, Lizzie.
Hey, wait a minute. Do you mean the cops are coming here? Rhonda, you're terrific. That means I'm going back to Wentworth.
And this?
What is it?
It's a car radio.
Oh, yeah.
Lizzie, what on earth possessed you to steal a car radio?
Do you own a car?
Who, me? A car? You gotta be joking.
No, of course she doesn't. None of us do.
Better check it.
Oh, really? Oh, come on, Lizzie. Where'd you get the car radio?
I don't remember.
Oh, for goodness sake, you can remember where you got everything else. Why can't you remember where you got the radio?
Oh, the rest of it's easy. Most of it came from the same store. Hasn't it got a name on it? I'll tell you what, though. I can take you there.
Right. Well, we'll go and have a look then, on the way to the station.
Are you taking me in?
Of course they're taking you in, you dope. But you'll get out on bail, won't you, Constable? I mean, she has cooperated and everything.
Well, there shouldn't be a problem. She'll be up before the beak in the morning.
Bail? I won't pay it.
Pardon?
I won't pay it. Don't forget, I'm a pensioner.
Lizzie, if you don't pay bail, they'll hold you in the police station till morning.
Is that right?
Well, not exactly, no. You said we don't have a policewoman on duty.
Well, that's it. You're headed straight for Wentworth.
Oh. I've broken the law, Rhonda. I have to face up to me punishment.
No car. Righto, well, let's get this lot cleaned up then.
There he is now. Hey, Bobby. Right here, Jim.
Here, Judy, try this. It's not exactly Christmas, but it's the best I could do.
Where did you get that?
Oh, well, I haven't been out of here that long. I've lost all my contacts.
That's fantastic. It's going to make it look real nice, though.
Boys found a section fence down first thing in the morning.
Bloody soap operas. Isn't there anything decent on this? Well, well, look who's back from the black hole of Calcutta. Welcome to the world of the living. You okay? Oh, yeah, what? The rest did me the world of good.
Oh, yeah, I bet it did. Bloody Sharon Gilmore. Don't worry, she'll get hers.
It was me they put in the pound, B, not you.
And what's that supposed to mean?
Well, if there's any getting to be done, it should be me who does it.
But you won't.
Oh, look, I've done the spell in the pound. I'm out now. Can't we leave it at that?
No way. Gilmore put you in there. I'm going to get the bitch.
All these vendettas, B, they don't do you any good.
Keep me on top.
Yeah, on top of the muck heap.
Now, where are those two off to?
Oh, well, Judy's moving into Sharon's cell.
Well, did you hear that, girls? Bryant and Gilmore have finally got themselves a honeymoon suite in the Wentworth Hilton. Isn't that just ducky?
Oh, leave him alone, B. At least Judy will be able to keep Sharon in line now from now on.
Oh, yeah? I believe that when I see it.
You manage all right?
Yes, thanks.
I'll leave you to it.
Well, you're going to sit there staring at me all day? You're going to give me a hand here?
One enough.
Take the pot plant, will you?
Where would you like?
Anywhere you like, love, you know. It's a gift for you. From me. Sort of peace offering.
I'm sorry.
Oh, don't be sorry. It was your pot plant.
All right, Judy, I know. That was stupid and childish of me. I'm sorry, okay?
Look, we're going to be in here an awful long time. Why don't we try and get on, huh?
Yeah.
Let's forget the past few weeks. Start all over again. Be like we were on the outside. Okay?
Okay.
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 Now, you clean up this mess, huh? We'll make a home for ourselves.
Hang on a minute. It's not as imaginative as your gift to me, I know. But I'd like you to have it.
Thanks.
Yeah, what are these for?
Those?
Yeah.
They're pills.
Yeah?
Yeah. I got them given to me by the nurse. You know, she was checking me over, found I had a bit of blood pressure.
Well, what did she say is causing it?
Oh, she had a few calculated guesses. And I didn't like to contradict her.
Oh, hello, Vera. Losing a bit of weight there, aren't you, love?
Birdsworth, what are you doing here at this time of night? Oh.
I did the wrong thing. I stole a few bits and pieces out of a few shops and that.
So you're right back where you started.
Yeah. I don't know what came over me, Vera, honest.
And it says here you're being held without bail pending a hearing at the magistrate's court tomorrow.
That's right, love.
Well, for a start, Birdsworth, you can get rid of the Loves and the Veras.
Oh, all right, Miss Bennett.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Oh, good luck! Such a nice little man looked after me like a mother looking after its child.
That's enough of the chatter, Birdsworth. You know the procedure from here on in.
Yeah. Would it be all right if I moved in with Doreen and B?
You'll go where I put you.
Oh, be nice to be in.
They're all in with Pat O'Connell. There's no room for you.
Di Stewart?
No.
Helen Rowlands?
No.
Oh, okay.
You'll have a nice little cell to yourself.
I don't care if it rains or...
Shut up, Birdsworth!
Oh, sorry! Hey, this is C block!
No, 10 out of 10, Birdsworth.
But I thought I'd at least be close to the other so I could shout at them through the wall or something.
And I thought I said you'd go where I put you.
Oh, fair go, Miss Bennett.
If you wanted to make social calls on all your friends, Birdsworth, being arrested for theft is no way to go about it. No inside.
Oh, dark as the inside of a dog.
Sweet dreams.
morning, Miss Bennet.
Good morning, Mrs. Davidson.
Quiet night?
Not entirely.
Oh, Lizzie Birdsworth. Before you go, would you leave word? I want us here in my office.
I'll bring her myself after they've had breakfast.
Thank you, Miss Bennet.
My pleasure.
Oh, and there's maple syrup. That's the only thing.
A bit noisy, aren't they?
Oh, no more than usual. Mm. Did you come for breakfast?
No. I just came in early so that I could catch them all together. I've got an announcement to make, if you don't mind.
Not at all.
Thank you. Ladies. Ladies, could I have your... Thank you, Mrs. Jackson. Ladies, I just dropped in to let you know that I've arranged for a group of actors, together with all their props, scenery, costuming, etc., to come out here to Wentworth on Wednesday evening. Now, that's the day after tomorrow, for those of you who've let your diaries lapse.
Oh, I had a previous engagement, wasn't I?
Never mind about your other engagement. They'll be performing their latest play for you.
Oh, wow.
Don't get excited. I said performing a play for you, not making a play for you. Right. Now, seriously, girls, I'd like you not only to give these people your support, but to take particular notice of what goes on. There'll be refreshments served after the play. The cast and crew will stay behind to have a chat about their group's dramatic activities.
Romeo, Romeo, where are you, Romeo?
Wherefore art thou, you twit?
I'm up here on the chair, you idiot.
Can I ask you first? To be or not to be?
Is that supposed to be a dig at me?
Be, I'm back.
What is Lizzie Birdsworth doing back here?
Shoplifting.
Oh. Listen, if you get a minute later on, could you come to my office, please?
Sure.
Thank you.
I was going bloody scary out there, fair dinkum.
Oh, I didn't want to go to that man of trouble to get put back inside. It's going to be stark raving bonkers. What am I going to do with you? You wanted to see me?
Yes, come in, ma'am. Sit down, please. Listen, Pat O'Connell, how do you think she would cope with another appeal?
Oh, I don't know. Is there going to be one?
No, it's possible. I know the last one was dismissed on the grounds of Herbie's evidence. But despite her withdrawal, her behaviour has improved. One could almost say that she's mellowed.
Well, she did spend that time in solitary.
Oh, well, I've got my doubts about the circumstances surrounding that. Anyway, another appeal is on the cards. It's just a question of whether or not Pat can put up with another round or two in the judicial arena.
Yes. Oh, that reminds me.
What?
Jeff Butler goes on trial in a couple of days. I must organise some time off.
What, are they calling you as a witness?
Oh, they are indeed. Judicial arena just about sums it up, doesn't it? No matter which side of the fence you're on, it's a battle. Just the thought of having to give evidence terrifies me. So God knows how Pat O'Connell's going to feel when it's her future at stake. And she's already lost that battle twice.
Given up fighting, that's all. No guts, if you ask me.
Lizzie Birdsworth would have more guts than 10 of you put together, and I wasn't asking you anyway. I was talking to Pat.
Oh, well, she could be right, though. I mean, not about having no guts, but about giving up the fight.
Lizzie's been fighting for the last quarter of a century, right in here. In here! Okay, maybe she didn't win, but she survived. She learned to roll the punches in here. But out there...
Well, anything would be better than rotting away in this stinking hole.
Well, for you, maybe. But what about Lizzie? What's out there for her? She's not going to meet some nice bloke and settle down and get married and have kids. It's too late for Lizzie.
What's going to happen to you when they turn you loose, Bee? You'll be in the same boat as Lizzie.
I happen to be a bit younger than Lizzie.
How long have you got to go, Pat?
18 months.
Oh, well, it won't be too bad for you then, will it? You'll still have your kids waiting for you when you get home. And the world won't have passed you by altogether.
Why, Lizzie? Why won't you pay the fine?
Well, I got to serve time for the shoplifting. So it'll be cheaper to serve a bit extra time for the fine.
And how much do you think you'll get for both of these? 1 month? 2 months?
Maybe. Maybe more.
And as far as you're concerned, the more the merrier, hmm? Well, you'll just have to think of something else.
I don't know what you mean.
I mean you are treating this place as though it is a hotel, and I assure you it is not. It is a corrective institution for real offenders.
But that's what I am. A habitual criminal.
Oh, nonsense. You're a conniving old woman who always wants her own way.
That's not true.
Of course it is. Lizzie, I know how difficult it must be for you adjusting to a whole new way of life, but you owe it to yourself to make that adjustment.
But I can't, Mrs. Davidson. Oh, it wasn't too bad when Dora was around, but when she got sent back...
Dora's not going to be in here for the rest of her life, nor are the rest of your friends. Don't you think you ought to be setting them a good example? Be there to help when their parole comes up?
Help? Like I did with Dora. It's all my fault that she got sent up again.
Well, I'm sure you've learned your lesson from that. Now, Lizzie, I can go along to the magistrate's hearing, try to get this whole mess all sorted out, and then you can start all over again. Will you let me do that?
Can't you just let things be? Can't I stay in here where I can't harm nobody? Well, I'm not worth bothering about.
Just because Sharon and I are sharing the same cell together doesn't mean it's the end of our friendship.
Yeah, but I bet she'll want you to work inside with her now that you've, you know...
Made up?
Yeah.
Listen, Sharon works where she wants to work. I work where I choose. And what we do with our spare time, well, that's a different kettle of fish. Okay?
Okay. But she sure gets awful jealous, doesn't she?
Oh, she used to, honey, used to. That's all straightened out now.
Good. I'm glad.
Listen, we do have a problem, though.
What?
Well, who's that friend of yours they brought in last night?
Lizzie Birdsworth?
Yeah. I understand she used to work in the garden. And if she wants to work in the garden again, one of us is going to have to go.
Oh, poor Lizzie. Wish I knew what went on in her head, silly old twit. She was out on parole, she had a decent pension, and I even said she could live with Kevin and I once. Judy, what's wrong?
How many times do I have to tell you there's nothing wrong with me? Look, I bent over to pull out a tomato plant. The blood must have rushed to my head, that's all. I just felt a bit dizzy.
Of course, it wouldn't have anything to do with you being hit on the head, would it?
Yeah, it could have. I mean, I have slight concussion, that's all, but I'm fine now, honest, I feel fine.
I'm sure you are, but it won't hurt to have the doctor check you over.
I don't need a doctor.
And I don't need an inmate collapsing and not receiving proper medical attention. No matter how you feel, you're our responsibility.
Okay. You get me a piece of paper and a pen. I'll sign an affidavit saying I've refused medical attention and I can go back to work then.
Well, that's exactly what I will do. Nurse, get me one of those forms, please.
Yes, certainly.
No doctor then?
No doctor. But you're not going back to work. You can stay here for the rest of the day and put your feet up.
Oh, but I...
No buts. Now, you keep an eye on her, check her. And if she has any more dizzy spells, report to me at once. If you think she's okay, she can go back to her cell.
Right.
Come on, Mrs. J, get with it.
How's Judy?
She'll be okay.
What's that about Judy?
She's just had a dizzy spell, that's all.
Where is she?
She's in her cell resting. Now, come along, move
can
it.
Can I see her, Mrs. Jackson?
For Public Enemy 5,852.
Hey, you've been promoted.
Oh, move along, Smith.
Give my life to the beak, Lizzie.
Will do. And keep the billy on. I'll be home for tea.
Right.
Yes, I heard about the disturbance in the dining room this morning.
And I can imagine who told you. Anyway, Ken Pierce is coming out here to have a look at our facilities this afternoon.
Ken Pierce? That name rings a bell.
Oh, well, he's the producer, director, manager, general dog's body for this drama group.
But I seem to connect the name with something else. Oh, well, no matter. So he's looking for a suitable place to put on the play?
Yeah, I thought of using the dining room, if that's okay with you. There's plenty of space there. It'll make things easier for putting on the tea and biscuits afterwards.
Be fine.
Good, good. Oh, could you file that for me, please? I'm finished with it.
Pat O'Connell's file?
Yes, I've spoken to her solicitor about the possibility of another appeal.
And?
It's hard to say. I brought her up to date on O'Connell's record of behaviour, but we'll just have to wait and see. The police here for Lizzie Birdsworth?
Yes, and I'm going along too. Hopefully I'll be able to persuade the magistrate to be lenient. Mm. Silly woman. She can't keep coming back here for the rest of her life.
It must be damn difficult for her. She's already spent 20 years of her life here.
Yes, I realize that, but Ah, Lizzie, there you are. We'll have to get a move on or we're going to be late.
You standing up for me then?
Yes, I am. And I don't want any arguments because there isn't any time.
You okay?
Of course I am. Why wouldn't I be?
Well, I didn't know what to expect. All they told me was you'd had a dizzy spell and you were in the hospital.
Yeah, well, that's all it was, you know. I mean, they just asked me to come back here and have a rest, that's all.
Well, what's causing it, though?
Well, how should I know? I just felt dizzy.
Have you taken your pills today?
I forgot.
Oh, well, no bloody wonder you got dizzy.
Listen, I've been through all this with Mrs. Jackson. She says there's nothing to worry about. It's all right.
Yeah, well. Here. Come on, take it.
Look, you know you're worse than a mother. I wish you'd go away and leave me alone and get some rest.
Okay. What's wrong?
Oh, I've been leaning on my arm. I feel pins and needles, you know? Come on now, I think I should get some rest.
What I was saying.
Don't you think you said enough in the magistrate's court? I told you not to bother about me, but what do? Stick your bib in and now look.
I did it for your own good.
For my good? God! You might as well have stuck a knife in my back.
Oh, don't talk nonsense.
Lizzie! Mrs. Davidson!
Bloody hell!
She got off.
Well, not exactly. She was fined $10.
$10? What's the magistrate? A relative?
No. I explained the situation, and he let her off with a light fine.
And she paid it?
No, I paid it. I also paid the first fine.
Wasting your money, I'd say.
Do you know where she's going?
Well, to the pub. Where else?
Would you fetch her for me?
No way. Getting her out of there in the mood she's in would be a bit like pulling a tooth from a tiger, liable to get your hand bitten off. Anyway, I'm on my way to work. Don't worry about her, Mrs. Davidson. She'll just get drunk, come staggering back here and sleep it off.
Waiting to see me?
Unfortunately, no. I'm Kemp Pierce. I have an appointment with Mr. Reed.
Oh, how do you do? Erica Davidson, Governor of Wentworth.
Delighted to meet you, Mr. Davidson.
Mr. Reed speaks very highly of you and your drama group, Mr. Pierce. He tells me you are the cornerstone of the whole enterprise.
Well, cornerstone could be slightly misleading.
Well, actually, he said you were the producer, director, business manager, and general dog's body.
That could be a more accurate description.
Excuse me, Mr. Pierce. Mr. Reed will see you now.
Thank you.
I'm going that way. Have you signed in?
Yes.
Oh, good. I'll show you to his rooms.
Come in. Ken, good to see you.
How are you, Paul?
Sorry I had to keep you waiting.
Oh, don't apologize. You gave me a chance to get to know your governor.
Good. Well, let's all sit down, make ourselves comfortable. You will stay for a while, won't
you? Yes, of course.
Good, good. Oh, by the way, how did Lizzie Birdsworth get on?
Well, she was let off with a $10 fine, but I'm afraid she'll be back. When I last saw her, she was heading for the hotel. I'll tell you about it later. Oh, please excuse this shop talk, Mr. Pierce. Now then, Mr. Reed, I want to hear all about this drama group.
Oh, well, Ken, that's your territory. You're the expert.
Oh, that's a promotion from Dog's Body.
What's that?
Oh, nothing. It's just a private joke between Mr. Pierce and myself.
Oh, already? I see. Well, 20 years in jail hasn't affected your way with the ladies, has it?
You served a full 20 years in prison?
And then some. I was originally sentenced for 5 years for robbery with violence. I busted out after 3 years and stayed loose long enough to have a crack at armed holdup. Well, that was one big foul-up, I can tell you. I was recaptured 2 days later and the judge gave me 20 years. He said I was a hopeless, irretrievable and hardened criminal.
Did he set a non-parole period?
Mm-hmm. 7 years.
And you still serve the full 20?
I'm afraid so, yeah. Well, I blew any chances I might have had by conducting my own private war with the authorities. Before I knew it, 10 years had gone past.
Sounds very much like a woman we have here at Wentworth.
Oh, yes, yes, B. Smith. You'll no doubt meet her while you're here.
Oh, someone should tell her there's no future in fighting the system.
I agree. But please go on with your story.
Oh, there's not much more to tell, really. I got my head down, tail up, and decided to put the remaining years behind bars to good use. It took a few years, but I suddenly woke up to the fact that, despite all those years behind bars, I still had a future.
How's it look?
What?
This. How's it look?
Oh, great.
What's wrong with you?
Nothing. Fingers are sore from stitching, that's all.
You look a bit down.
Oh, geez, what do you expect being stuck in here still? So I suppose this thing reads all the night, so it'll be good for a laugh. All them poofs mincing around.
Oh, they're not necessarily all poofs.
Whop them actor blokes. You've got to be kidding. Where have you been hiding?
Oh, what's the difference? They're not going to let us near any of them anyway.
Yeah, can you imagine getting one of them alone in here for 5 minutes?
Thanks, doll. It was real nice. Nothing like the real thing. Yeah, well, I think I'll watch television instead.
Morning, Sally.
Morning, Mr. Reed.
Oh, listen, if Michael Simpson phones again today, would you put him through to my office or Mrs. Davison's office, please? Yeah.
Was there something else, Mr. Reed?
No, that's all. Thanks.
All right, Sally, Paul.
Jim, can I see you for a moment?
What's up?
I had a phone call yesterday from Michael Simpson.
What did he want?
He wanted to talk to Carolyn. I told him that she was out on bail. He then demanded to know where she was living and or the telephone number.
You didn't tell him?
Of course I didn't tell him. I told him that there was no phone under the house where she's living and I couldn't give him the address without her consent.
Good. So what's the problem?
Well, he sounded very angry, started muttering veiled threats about people in high places, ways and means of finding these things out. So I thought I'd better warn you. He may find out where she's living. He may even come here. And if I'm any judge, I'd say that we're in for a whole lot of trouble from Mr. Michael Simpson.
Turn that noise off, Smith. Right, you can all stop work and listen to me for a moment. The laundry's to be shut down for the day at lunchtime.
Yay!
Mrs. Davidson wants you to stay behind in the dining room and get it scrubbed up for this play that's going on tonight.
It'll only get mucked up at tea time.
You'll be eating in your cells tonight. And I've been asked to check your efforts. So let me assure you that if there's one speck of dust in that dining room, you'll do it again and again until I'm satisfied it's clean. Oh, not you again.
Now, don't be like that. I'm a member of the general public, and it's my taxes that go towards paying your wages.
Well, is that so? Well, what do you want this time? Bed and breakfast? Room with a view?
I've come to see Dor.
You can't.
Why not?
Because I say so.
Bitch. Don't you dare, Vera Bennett. You lay one finger on me, and I'll have you up for assault. You just try it. I got witnesses and all. That made you back down, didn't it?
Oh, no, don't tell me.
It's okay, Fletcher. I've only come to visit.
That's what she thinks. And it's Mr. Fletcher to you.
Who do you want to see?
Door. Anderson's already had one visitor this week. Birdsworth knows the rules.
Miss Bennett's right, Lizzie. Only one visit a week.
All right, then I'll see B. Smith.
No.
Why not?
You saw her yesterday at breakfast.
Oh, that wasn't a visit, you idiot. I was in the slammer myself.
You just watch your language.
Yeah, she does have a point, though, Miss Bennett. Look, Lizzie, could you wait outside for a minute, please?
When do I get to see B?
Well, I might just be able to arrange it. You can leave that bag here, okay? Well?
You're the deputy governor.
Fine, fine. Smith's in the dining room, isn't she, getting set up for tonight's play?
Yes. Yet another worthless exercise.
What, the play? Or scrubbing up the dining room?
Well, haven't you got anything better to do?
So every time there's a run on shoplifting, you'll be the first person they'll check up on, Lizzie. I'll find the stuff, return it, hit you with a fine and nothing else.
They can't force me to pay the fines, can they? And Mrs. Davidson will soon get sick of paying them for me.
They can take it out of your pension.
Can they do that? It's my money.
Of course they can. Let's get a court order and that's that.
Supposing I smashed all the stuff I stole. They couldn't return it then, could they?
They'd still take the money for it out of your pension. You'd be paying up for the rest of your life.
Bloody marvellous. For 20-odd years, they've been falling over each other to keep me inside, and now they're falling over each other to keep me out. I don't get it.
No, it's all politics, Lizzie. There's still some very red faces around because you were wrongly convicted before. They want you out and free so they can prove to the rest of the world what wonderful human beings they really are, after all. And you and me, and the rest of us, we're just the ham and the sandwich.
Time's up.
Already?
Yes, already. Now hurry up, Smith. It's almost lunchtime.
You have to accept it, Lizzie. Take what's dished out to you. And try not to let those bastards get you down.
Oh.
Oh, Meg, I'd like you to meet Ken Pierce. Ken, this is Mrs. Meg Jackson.
Delighted to meet you, Mr. Jackson.
You too. Well, this is your theatre for the evening. I hope it's okay.
Well, fine, just fine.
Well, that's dinner over. Perhaps you'd like to direct operations, show them where you want everything?
Sure.
Yeah, Ken, I'll leave you to it.
Yeah, thanks, Paul.
Ladies, I'd like to introduce you to Mr. Pierce.
The name's Ken, please.
Oh, Ken. Well, Ken and his drama group are performing the play for you tonight.
It doesn't look like
Ken,
a theory
to
me.
How would you know? Things, show them where you want things.
Okay, well, first of all, ladies, could we get rid of some of these tables, please?
Yes, Beth, what is it?
All the tables?
Well, the more space we have.
And what are we going to do about the refreshments afterwards? Eat them off the floor?
Of course, refreshments. After more than 20 years in jail, I should have realized. You look after your bed, your body, and your ablutions, right? And the rest can take care of themselves. What's your name?
B. Smith.
And is that a name or an initial?
Name. B-E-A.
Do you mind if I call you that?
If you like.
Fine. Oh, and thanks for reminding me about my priorities.
So what about the tables?
Well, put a couple of them over there for the tea and pickies and clear the rest away.
Would you like me to get them moving for you?
Could you?
Okay, girls, you heard what the man said. Come on, let's go. Move it.
Well, he seems to have injected some enthusiasm into it.
Yeah, I'm not sure it's the idea of seeing the play, the refreshments afterwards, or the break in the routine that's causing all the enthusiasm.
Cynic. You going to stay behind? Might be worth watching.
No. My evening's all tied up.
Oh, yes, I forgot. Oh, it comes with living on your own. Wife, family, house. The full catastrophe, eh?
Yeah, the full catastrophe.
Well, you've got quite a way with the other women here. They certainly take notice of you.
They know it's good for them.
Do they stick with you?
Us cons stick together.
That's great. That's the way it should be. We should all help each other. Cons and ex-cons.
No, Ken. You got it wrong. I thought you drama people knew all about the goodies and the baddies. You see, I said us cons. Now, in my book, we're the goodies. And that doesn't include ex-cons that worm their way in with the screws and try and make out their only concern is helping us poor buggers who are left inside. For mine, they're worse than screws. They're traitors.
Yeah. That's the first.
Jim Fletcher would be here.
No, he's got family commitments, I think.
Well, if it's anything like the Christmas show, he hasn't missed a thing.
Exeter State Prison couldn't provide. Yeah.
I was the one with the hair.
With that moustache and tickle. He's got his blankets.
Oh, yes. It's been too long. Hey, there's one for Vera.
Oh, she's got one.
Now, ladies, may I have your attention, please? While our actors are preparing for tonight's piece, I would first of all like to welcome you to this performance by the D4 Players and to give you some idea of our background. First of all, we were formed 5 years ago in Exeter State Prison, where a handful of us got together for debating and poetry reading, public speaking, etc. From an original membership of five, hence the handful, we now have some 50 to 60 prisoners actively involved. Well, naturally, they couldn't all be here tonight.
Oh, why not?
Well, some of them had to stay home and look after the store. And others had to go to bed early because they were naughty. From the odd one-act play, performed in areas much smaller than this, I might add, we've progressed to a point where we can perform full three-act plays in halls and theatres throughout the state. Of course, we have not yet progressed to the point where we can go out on our own. But it is comforting, particularly here tonight, to know that Big Brother is here to protect us and to look after us and make sure we don't get interfered with in the Black Hats.
Oh, yeah, with Big Brother.
Now, apart from performing, many of our members actually contribute by writing our own plays. We do all our own set designs and construction. We organize and record our own sound effects, etc. In fact, the full thing. And I can assure you, it's a lot of fun. Look, don't take my word for it. Just sit back and enjoy this play, which is a two-act play simply entitled Green.
Green?
Yeah. Oh, and by the way, if you're talking of titles, if you're wondering why we're called the D4 Players, it's quite simple. D for drama. Thanks, Mr. Jackson.
I'd rather you didn't. I'm babysitting.
You're babysitting?
Lizzie Birdsworth. She's just fallen asleep on my bed.
Well, I could shift her for you.
Oh, no, look, I don't want to wake her up. I couldn't stand another session of those bees won't let me back in with my friends.
She's not still on about that, is she?
Yes.
Well, why don't we go for a walk, get a bit of fresh air? Do you good.
Did you come all this way to ask me to go for a walk?
No, I haven't. Thought just occurred to me. Such a beautiful night. But I do have something I'd like to talk to you about.
Yeah, well, I couldn't agree more. Very, very well done. Congratulations. Excuse me a second. I'll just pop over and see Ken. Excuse me, girls. Excuse me. All right, well, did you enjoy the play?
Yeah, not bad.
And obviously you're acquainted with Ken.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, I'll mingle.
Okay.
It's a nice title.
Big pardon?
Green, the title of the play. Says it all, really.
Oh, you think so?
Yeah, that poor bloke locked away in solitary all those years. No windows, no sunlight. She's just about to give you a right arm for a blade of grass.
You sound as though you know the feeling.
Yeah, I know the feeling. You know, I'm no theatre critic, but I reckon the bloke that wrote that play must have been there too. I mean, he knew what it was all about, and when he got out, he really stuck it right up the screws. Must have been one hell of a guy.
So you don't think he was a traitor, eh?
No, of course not. You wrote it.
Yeah. And you're right, I'm no traitor. And neither was Steve, the guy in the play. But he was an idiot.
How do you mean?
Because, as you say, he stuck it up the authorities.
And that makes him an idiot?
Yes. Because it cost him his life. And that's the real meaning behind the title Green. It's nothing at all to do with trees and wide open spaces. It was him. Steve's as green as they come.
And you're not?
I'm alive.
And sticking it up the authorities.
Look, why don't we talk about you forming your own drama group here at Wentworth? Do you think the others would be interested?
They might be.
Thank you for the walk. And the drink. And for caring enough to come over and warn me about Michael. I certainly hope he doesn't find out where I live.
Well, he won't find out from me. Or anyone else at the prison. Not unless you want him to.
I don't care if I never set eyes on him again.
Will I call in tomorrow just to see how you are?
I don't think that's very wise, do you?
No, no, perhaps not. Now I feel very silly. I feel like a teenager trying to find an excuse to see his girl again.
Was the story about Michael an excuse to come over?
Oh, no, 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 it wasn't. Came in very handy, though.
And you can't think of one for tomorrow night?
Afraid not.
What about the night after?
Oh, I'm sure I'll find one by then.
Was that your wife's car or something?
No, no. Leela thinks that I'm at the prison watching a play. I'd better go.
Got a wife and kiddies, do you?
Get off my bed.
Not that that should make any difference. He's not supposed to be seeing the likes of you. No fraternizing with the prisoners in or out of jail. That's the rules. Fletch the Letch strikes again. Could cost him his job, you know. Oh, bugger you. Bugger him, too. Why the hell should I worry about his bloody job? Serves him right if they give him the big A. Bloody screws. Bastard.
Morning.
Oh, he's just walked in. Yes, Mrs. Davidson.
How's the play last night?
All right. Slightly more entertaining than watching monkeys pick fleas off one another.
Sounds like a great night. Glad I missed it.
Well, Mrs. Davidson wants to see you. Seems her phone's been running hot this morning. She's unhappy about something.
You want to see me, Mrs. Davidson?
Indeed I do, Mr. Fletcher. I want to know what has been going on between you and Carolyn Simpson.
I beg your pardon?
Carolyn Simpson, out on bail pending trial on charges of manslaughter. I received an anonymous phone call this morning giving me rather detailed information about your carryings on. Now, either the caller dreamed the whole thing up, or you have learned nothing from previous occasions when other sordid accusations were levelled against you. So I thought it only fair to afford you the opportunity to give your side of the story before I report the whole incident to the authorities. And I would appreciate your giving me the whole truth.
He used to give me roses. I wish he could again. But that was on the outside. And things were different then. On the inside, the sun still shines and the rain falls down, but the sun and rain are prisoners too when morning comes around. Last night I dreamed we were together, sharing all the love we'd known, till I had face the nightmare of waking up alone. On the inside the roses grow, they don't mind the stony ground, but the roses here are prisoners too when morning comes around.